Okay, so we're moving on to the next session. I'm Laura Morshan from the Sociology Department here at Sussex. And I'm delighted to introduce our next speakers, Dr. Michaela Benson and Professor Colonial O'Reilly. Michaela Benson is a reader in sociology at Goldsmiths University. She's widely known for her contributions to the sociology of migration, lifestyle migration in particular, as well as her work on class, home, and belonging. Michaela is currently leading a research project funded by the UK in a Changing Europe, a project which looks at the implications of Brexit for Britons residing in other EU member states. And this builds on her work on her previous work on the British in France. I'm sure many of you will have come across her book, The British in Rural France, which was shortlisted for the British Sociological Association's Philip Abrams Memorial Prize in 2012. Karen O'Reilly is Emeritus Professor of Sociology at Loughborough University. She has spent most of her career researching the British who migrate in search of a better way of life. She has published numerous books, including Ethnographic Methods, Key Concepts in Ethnography, Lifestyle Migration, The British on the Costa del Sol. Karen and Michaela have just completed a book on elite migration to Panama and Malaysia, and their joint presentation today will focus on the research on this topic.
Thanks, Laura. Thanks, everybody, for being here today. So Karen and I are going to do some quite ambitious for 20 minutes. We're going to try and summarise the whole book. We will teach 20 minutes, maybe 25. But yeah. So, as Laura said, we've recently completed a book manuscript on work we conducted independently of one another. My work with North Americans who'd relocated to Panama, and Karen's work on a project which included a study of British people moving to Malaysia. And what we try to do in the book is we tried to tell the story about these migrant lives, but through a lens that adopts practice stories. And our intention with this really is to tease out the different layers within these stories that tell us something about that interaction between structure and agency on various different levels. And it was a very exciting project. It's the first time we've written a book together. We've written many other things together. But through this process, I think, I hope we've successfully managed to uncover something of the complex interplay of post-coloniality and neoliberalism within lifestyle migration. I should just say as a caveat, we're not going to have time to go into a long discussion about the concepts of what they mean, so just bear with me. The story that we want to tell is a story about privilege. These are undoubtedly privileged populations in various ways. But we'd also like to remind you that when we talk about privilege, when we talk about affluence, we always talk about relative privilege and relative affluence. So that is to say that those privileges are located within a broader geopolitical structure, and that's what we're drawing attention to when we're talking about privilege and affluence, not necessarily individuals as privilege. So we're telling a strict tale about privilege and how this is structured, governed, and embodied. So we're going to go through very quickly the different components of these practice stories to give some initial insights into the way in which lifestyle migration is the site where post-coloniality and neoliberalism articulate. And we really do want to try and shift the focus from what has been in lifestyle migration, an examination of the individual migrant, and to look at how these migration practices reveal wider geopolitics and economic transformation.
So, yeah, we've probably done the wrong thing trying to produce the whole book in 20 minutes. And this slide alone I could probably talk to for about an hour, because I've also written a book around this topic. But just very briefly to say that what we're trying to do here is to frame our telling about the lives of these migrants using the meta-theoretical framework of practice stories or practice theory. Now, practice stories are my way of trying to talk about describing long-term ongoing processes. So thank you to Nancy and to Paul for reminding us this morning that history matters and the state still matters and those sorts of things we've been talking about so far. Is the aim of telling practice stories is to draw on the insights from practice theory that tells us that we don't just want to focus on history or structures or institutional arrangements or the norms that have got us where we are today, but also the practices, the daily practices of agents in their daily lives and how these things interact. So the key point of the book is to try to tell where we're at now as a story, sort of as a long ongoing process. So you're going to see that we're trying to say that history matters, that wider structures matter, that more local proximate structures, as in norms and rules and governance structures, matter. But these things have been designed by agents at a certain time, but not necessarily by the specific agents that we're focusing on here and now. So they appear to those agents as structures, but they are in turn embodied by them through processes such as whiteness, through processes such as colonialities of power. So we're trying to sort of get this theoretical framework in here in the telling of this migration process. Now we're hanging this on two key concepts. I'll put them the other way around, post-colonialism and neoliberalism. These are just shortcuts for us for talking about huge, massive, wider historical processes that have given us the conditions that we're in now, but also the sort of practices and norms that we're living with now. And neoliberalism too, in order to bring these kind of, the emphasis on privileged migrants somewhat up to date and to see them as migrants who are migrating now in current conditions, so not just post-colonial conditions. Methodologically, this has meant that, yes, Michaela and I both use ethnographies, our research is ethnographic, but to be honest, the data is pretty much out of date now, and it's been quite a long time now since we were either in Malaysia or Panama, but we don't consider that terribly relevant in as much as we're looking at a long-term historical process in terms of what came before, what happened during the process, and also what are some of the outcomes. So our key argument is that we're interested in the role of post-colonialism and neoliberalism for understanding how these make sense in people's actions today.
So briefly, just for people who I think I've sent that slide through, but never mind. Briefly, for those people who are not familiar with Panama or Malaysia, we thought we'd just provide a very, very quick intro. So we want to situate these migrations within these broader geopolitical histories of these two countries. And this is a way of providing a sense of the wider and more distant social structures that shape this migration, which has been seen to be a quite valuable component of practice stories, so it's quite central to the structure that we use to try and understand these types of migration. And quite simply, these geopolitical histories are structures that shape the opportunities these migrants have, and shape their ability to imagine a move to such a destination. But they're not structures over which they have any direct control. In both countries, we have Panama, which was very central in the Spanish colonialism project. The landmass that is currently in Panama was very central to that Spanish colonial project. And of course, in Malaysia was a British protectorate, so it was, again, very much caught up in that colonial project. But what's happening at the moment in terms of the economic development of those two countries is very much a shift towards some degree of neoliberal economy. So there's lots of special economic zones, free trade zones, and we have the development of opportunities for migrant investment in residential property is part of that wider shift, and that's where we want to locate that. Both countries have high levels of economic diversity and ongoing inequality along ethnic lines, and there's been various degrees of external interference in both countries, both by the British and North Americans in Panama. So quite simply, we just wanted to lay out the way in which these colonial histories can be read on the ground in places like, well, in Panama and Malaysia, but at the same time, their contemporary economic development is very much leading towards this neoliberal structure. So I'll hand over to Karen.
So you can see we're telling a story here. And we started off sort of broad and wide and sort of historically long distance structures that have shaped the globe and certainly shaped the destinations that these migrants have gone to. And it's also shaped how they see themselves and how they're seen by the people that they move amongst. It's given them economic advantages and it's given them certain embodied ways of being and ways of seeing themselves and ways of imagining their lives. So, but bringing this down to a much more proximate or closer level, if you like, we also drew attention to some of the things that are going on in Malaysia and Panama in terms of actually overtly attracting these migrants to their destination. Now, in Panama, this is absolutely overt and is labelled residential tourism. In Malaysia, it's a little more subtle, and of course there are all sorts of ways of attracting foreign direct investment, and this is just one of the ways. But one of the things that's going on is that these countries, among others, are attracting individual level investment in terms of property purchase or land purchase. So what we're trying to draw attention to here is that these are state-led developments, not driven by the individual migrants themselves, but also driven by state agents, but also by property agents, property developers, and things like that. We framed this discussion in our book around the concept of residential tourism. Because the language is used overtly in Panama, but also because I've done quite a lot of research in Spain, and it's possible that the whole concept of residential tourism originated there and was overtly called residential tourism. And I find it a really fascinating concept if you think about it, because it's kind of attracting people to resident, to become resident, to buy properties, but it's still calling them tourists. And in doing that, there's this kind of sleight of hand, as in, we want these people to come, we want them to settle, we want them to buy properties, but we don't actually want them to settle that much that they ever become a problem. So as soon as they become a problem, the states were kind of promoting residential tourism. And like, whoa, what happened there? Didn't really. So it's had really profound effects in Spain. And Spanish academics have written quite extensively about the environmental damage, social damage, disruption to communities, and as a result of the financial crisis, the abandonment of lots and lots of large towns and smaller towns. Nevertheless, around the world, different countries are using this model to try to attract individual level investment, that they don't call migration. And another aspect of that, of course, is that in attracting these migrants, they don't just say, oh, we'll come here, you know, you can get some cheap property. There's a lot of work that goes into imagining the place. So places become imagined as somewhere for certain types of desirable migrants to go to. So a lot of work goes into and written down here where how they're imagined. So here Panama is presented as safe and secure and cheap and convenient, and Boquete itself, where Nicola did her research, as for its rich environments, its beautiful natural surroundings, healthy lifestyle. And Panam is portrayed as the gateway to Peninsula Valencia, a centre for arts, culture, education, and of course for the health and medical benefits. And of course, you know, without us needing to say that, you will understand that these places don't have the same meanings for all types of migrants or all types of residents.
I think it's worth pointing out that on the real version of the site, of which this is not the real version, I put the an image taken from International Living, which is it's a long site. So from International Living, which is a kind of magazine and forum where people are advised on where to retire to. And Malaysia and Panama are listed consistently within the top 10 places in the world to retire to. And this is quite significant. There is an entire industry that has built up around attracting retirees and their money that they've earned in other countries to go and relocate to these places. It's a very, very big movement, and not one that we would regularly think about if we were asked, here is a migrant. We've argued elsewhere, and we'll continue to argue, that it's really important to recognise that this is part of a much broader political economy of migration. And as Karen's outlined, of course, you know, you've got this situation where states are doing things like redevelop and rezoning land specifically for residential development, and attracting these migrants through these kind of placemaking mechanisms. But they also develop these policy structures and these visas and regulations that facilitate the migration of these people. And both Panama and Malaysia have this offer. So the MM2H is actually the Malaysia My Second Home visa, and the Pensionado visa in Panama is one that's specifically oriented towards retirees. Notably, property investment is one element of these. So if you invest enough in property in these countries, then you get certain perks, certain access, if you have enough monthly income. So there are certain eligibility criteria. And in terms of local economies, these eligibility criteria are quite high, they're quite high incomes, but actually, on the very global level, we're not talking about the global elite, we're talking about the global middle class, essentially, who are being attracted to these places. So governments really are actively cultivating a scenario where people can go. Now, of course, among the people that we've spoken to, we're not just talking about people who do have the resources to come in through these visas. We also know of people who regularly use single entry visas. So you use a tourist visa, so just arrive at the border, pick up their visa, they go in and they stay for 90 days, 180 days, depending on what that visa allows. And then they will exit the country for 48 hours, 72 hours, get another visa and go back in. Notably, this escapes attention most of the time because these are not the populations perhaps that people are looking out for. But we do know of situations in both Panama and Malaysia where the governments have at various times decided they've got to crack down on these Westerners often and the abuse of these visas. But you can see in another situation, if you're talking about different migrant populations, then that blind eye will not be being turned in the same way. So it does draw attention to the way in which this migration governance is a practice that's continually ongoing, where government agents are setting things up, moving them to try and find ways of excluding the people that they don't want, so they don't want the migrants who are not investors, for example, and then the migrants find ways of manipulating those structures to their benefits. Did you want to add anything else on that?
No, except that, I mean, I don't think we're trying to argue that migration as this kind of practice is unique to this kind of scenario either. This focus on lifestyle migration makes us realise that even for these migrants, that there's constant tweaking. People learn how to play the system and get round it. Then migration systems or control the government systems catch up and then change their regulations. And then migrants themselves learn new ones, and it's just this constant game of cat and mouse, trying to keep who we want and who we don't want, excluding who we don't want. And it's even happening for lifestyle migrants because some of them are not wealthy. You know, we've met several who are definitely on the borders of wealthy. So working to exclude those that they don't want, even amongst these relatively privileged populations. Yeah, right. Okay. Running out of time already. So that's kind of the background, and then we moved on in the book to actually tell you about the migrants themselves. And the first chapter telling you about their stories we call weaving migration stories, and it's paying homage to the argument that, you know, when any migrant tells their story, they're telling a particular story for a particular audience. And then academics come along and also take that and weave their own stories with the argument they want to make as well. So we want to be clear that this is a set of migration stories that we're making because it's part of our practice stories. But we do want to draw attention to the fact that this was a very diverse population. As we said, some extremely wealthy, some not. People who are working, self-employed, very entrepreneurial type, and the very traditional corporate expatriate was caused us there as well, mainly in Malaysia more than in Panama. But also, you know, people, they liked the fact that we asked to talk to people who saw themselves as lifestyle migrants and embraced that notion that they were moving for looking for a lifestyle. Some had migration inscribed into the habitus, you know, they had a long history of migrating and came from families with a long history of migration, but others were new to migration, you know, working class people who'd never been abroad much before and just said, you know, I'm going to go, I'm going to give it a go, looking for a new adventure. But amongst this, there's always these stories of practice, these stories of people who did have definitely privileged levels of resources, privileged levels of governance control over their lives, but had to keep negotiating that, had to manage how much the money they got, maybe consider going home because they couldn't cope with different things, thinking about their health care, thinking about their relationships with home and family. So they're also stories of constant compromise and learning to live a new life.
And I think that's particularly clear when we look at what's happening with the world of work in relation to these migrant populations. So certainly in some of the other work that we've done, work wasn't perhaps the biggest factor in British people in Spain and France. Well, not to the same extent as we find when we moved to Northern and Panama.
I should have said there are a lot of retired people.
Yeah.
so busy making the point that they're not all retired. I forgot to say that, of course, they're not all retired.
So what we pick up through that is the changing nature of corporate work as well and what the expatriate package is. It doesn't really come with all of the perks that it once did. And actually that's telling more generally of labour economies and what's happening there. But even though a lot of them are also retired, there's a huge amount of volunteering work that goes on, charity work that goes on, philanthropy. They're always keeping themselves very, very busy. You know, getting involved certainly in Panama, getting involved with changes that on the ground that can help diverse people. So, for example, starting up blood banks, hospice care, all of the things that are not readily available within the local economy, they're finding ways of making for themselves, but also helping the indigenous community and doing those types of things. And I have been quite critical of that in some of my other writing, I should just say. I'm not going to have a lot of time to go into that now. But this work of making the lives they have imagined is definitely going on in their everyday lives. Do you want to say something about that?
I'm a little bit at home, I think, just very briefly, and then health as well. I think the main point, I guess, we're trying to make about these people and their lives is that it would be very easy to be very critical and say, oh, look, just go there, and these are pictures that either I took there or was sent there. Nicholas haven't appeared on this version of the slides. But you can see here, they sent this picture, a group of people, they're meeting Kate. Yeah. And the others are showing that their travels around the world. And it would be very easy to say, well, they're privileged people, very, very opulent dwellings. And this is definitely true. But if you actually spend time with them and understand where they've come from and what their expectations are and what the opportunities are when they live there, that, you know, just like everyone else, they have to make a home for themselves and they have to get a sense of belonging. And the way they get a sense of belonging is amongst their own communities, is amongst people that like them. And as Nicola was just saying about the volunteer work, by doing volunteer work, you're kind of reinforcing and re-expressing this sense of distance and privilege and hierarchy. And it's so that they become, it becomes part of their practice, this reproduction of privilege is something they take part in every day, not necessarily consciously realizing that they're doing it. It's part of making themselves at home, making friends, building a social life. And then another aspect of this, just briefly, and I think one thing that's also important when we're talking about practice stories is not just that what happened before, but what's happening in the future, what the outcomes are of this. And some of the outcomes of these kinds of migration we're noticing are new ways of living, new ways of having communities, but also in places like this, they're part of the imagining is, you know, this is somewhere to live a healthy life, this is somewhere to live, you know, a good spiritual life. And then comes with that masses of industries, of course, So you've got the retirement industries, the health industries, which also are targeted at people who are wealthy. So within this neoliberal environment, there's this space for the creation of yet more and more industries that help the wealthy and help them set up and have what they want. But they're not available, increasingly not available to local people, to poorer people.
And even to some of the migrants within those populations. So, I'm going to close. So, what we really wanted to draw out here is the fact that, you know, on the surface, we could say very straightforwardly that these types of movement of these relatively privileged populations, as we've referred to them elsewhere, follow quite well established routes. And those are well established routes developed through colonial histories, developed through global trade relations, and they reflect long-standing relationships between countries, and it's difficult to ignore the global inequalities of power that facilitate and shape these lifestyle migration flows to the global south and east. And lifestyle migrants, who are often white, although not exclusively, particularly in Karen's case, middle class and in receipt of larger incomes than many within the local population, often enter quite high at the top of local racial and social class hierarchies. That's undeniable. They're in a position of power within the destination. I'll never forget my first trip to Panama, I'm sure many people have heard me say this before, arriving at this meeting in the middle of nowhere and waiting for the science and technology minister of Panama to come in on his helicopter to this group of North Americans, most of whom would never have met an elected official in their own country. And I think that illustrates quite clearly where their position. And as Sheila Crouch's reminded us, this undeniable position of power they occupy is part of the reality of the everyday life that these lifestyle migrants live within such destinations, and it does reveal ongoing legacies of the relationship to colonialism. But however powerful, this understanding is only partial. What we try to tell in the book is lifestyle migration is a story of practice, as an ongoing process through which individualized subjects take responsibility for and seek to improve their quality of life. And the privilege of these migrants is practiced through the articulation of post-colonialism and neoliberalism, and so you see the resonance of the colonial past and the neoliberal present. But nevertheless, I think it's important that we don't forget that quite often, particularly for those who have lived and worked in these kind of neoliberal economies, there is a compulsion to improve things for yourself, and that's very much part of the habitus of these people. So our argument seeks to position the wider structural and material conditions that support migration alongside the proximate structures that benefit lifestyle migrants and over which they have some limited agency. And it's at this scale that neoliberalism as a mechanism of governance functions, shaping the form that lifestyle migration takes. But it's also clear that within the body of the lifestyle migrant lies a foreign neoliberal subject, at once the target of promotion and governance, and a self-directed, enterprising individual who, through their migration and in deploying their resources and capitals, seeks to carve out a better way of life for themselves. So thank you very much.
Volunteering as a volunteer, and others and helping and so on. And I think the imagery had there for big check. I think that was part of that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you could just say a bit more about that local print.
I think it's actually different in both cases. So I'll talk a little bit about Panama and then I'll leave. What was really clear to me when I worked in Panama, having studied British people and having some kind of common level of understanding, was the fact that I did not understand those Americans at all, and the role that particularly that their philanthropic activities in Panama were very often a continuation of philanthropic activities that they've been involved with in the US. So lots of them were in the Rotary Club and in the Lions Club, and they've been in those beforehand, or they've been very involved in church communities, and they continued doing that when they moved to Panama. But I do think that there is an element of the extent to which some of their activities were an effort to displace their feeling that somehow they were exceptional, that somehow they were privileged. So I do think that there is a bit of that. Although these things were directed both towards helping out the North American migrant community and towards doing things that they thought would be for the benefit of the local community with greater and lesser degrees of success and with greater and lesser understandings of the structural causes of the things that they thought that they were trying to ameliorate. So they're very rarely actually focused on bringing about any level of structural change at all. But I think yours, I don't know about yours.
I would say very similar, but what happens is that people will join associations and organisations and very often start off by saying, I'm not going to join any organisations, I'm not going to be a Brit award, that's what they will say. And then, you know, they need some friends, and they make friends with people they can talk to, and these tend to be through associations. And then one of the things that's going on in the associations is that people are doing voluntary work, and it makes them feel, it gives them a sense of belonging, a sense of community. Unfortunately, I'm not absolutely sure that it's unfortunately, but they tend to be the kind of sort of bestowing largesse on the less fortunate. And so it has these kind of colonial undertones, hence the ghostly pictures that were supposed to be on the slides, sort of suggesting the ghost of the colonial past there. What's driving it very often? And also, when we're talking about, we use the concept from other people of the trailing spouse, you know, the expatriate who's moved, and the wife, usually the wife, but not always, who suddenly finds their career is on hold. And then it's looking for something to do, something fulfilling to do with their lives, the same with retired people. And migration disrupts your sense of who you are, your sense of continuity, your sense of the past, and so it gives people a sense of place, definitely.
Hello, thank you for the presentation. I'm from Malaysia. I just want to find out if the global elites, quote unquote, as we mentioned earlier, whether they are making any efforts to integrate into the host societies, or is there like a social bubble that you see going on? Thank you.
It's a complicated answer because it depends on which global elite we're talking about. And if you were to focus only on maybe corporate expatriates, people who are working within the framework of organisations, I think that very much depends on your corporation and who you're working with and what sorts of access you have to other types of people. But I understand that these corporate packages are changing and there is a lot more effort to try to employ local labour and for people to get to know local people. But that we were less interested in talking to expatriates. Research has been done on that field. And we were more interested in, I suppose, in the individual entrepreneurial lifestyle made migrant. We did include people who were expatriates, but very often people who were there because their partner was working as an expatriate and they were there, they saw themselves as there for quality of life reasons. And I found exactly the same as I did in Spain, my research in Spain, that people wanted to, and they said, you know, I really would like to get to know the locals, and I really have tried, but access is very difficult, language is very difficult, and then it becomes very easy to make friends with people like you and to end up getting to know people like you. There are those who have broken out, but then of course that seems to be at a very class level, so then social class comes into play. So you know, they would tell me that they're friends with, you know, this high level person, this high level bureaucrat, or you know, this person of the same class background as them. I could spend quite a long time here telling you about a particular organisation that they called themselves the International Women's Association, and what's that anyway? Like, who's an international woman and who isn't? While I was there, they were having this great big debate about who counts as an international woman. And obviously some people not wanting to say, well, we mean anyone who's international but not a Latin. So, but it just got really, really ridiculous because of all these levels of debate. In fact, it ended up with complete disruption and the group disbanded.
I think the thing to add to that question is that, you know, it's not... Within any of these populations, there are going to be really diverse motivations for being there, but also really diverse lives within that. And so there will be people who do have those relationships, and there will be people who don't have those relationships. And one of the things we've been very keen on for the last 10 years that we've been working together is to precisely say, okay, well, down with the stereotypes of the more privileged populations as much as with the stereotypes of the more disadvantaged migrant populations that we're very, very familiar with. Because the stereotypes are not useful. So we've been interested to find out what's behind that. And that's not to say that we're not critical of the extent to which some people might draw more enclave living. And things like that. But we're always very wary of those stereotypes. We're very keen to actually find out what's happening on the ground and to recognise that there's a huge amount of diversity within any population of that kind that needs to be drawn attention to.
It raises the question, what would integration actually look like for any migrant group, I think? We have to be, this has been kind of the elephant in the room today, you know, this notion of integration, and I don't think we always really know what it actually would look like. That's really the idea. Segmented assimilation in the US, and is this integration?
Okay, I think we have time for one brief question.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I have a conceptual mythological question, namely the relationship between practice theory and story. If you look at the genre of narrative or story, I mean, from depending which discipline you're from, but that's kind of the interaction making way that humans do. So what would practice theory and which tradition of that, what would it bring to the table?
In international migration and social theory, I actually set up my approach to practice theory, which relies very heavily on Giddens and Bourdieu and Rob Stone's strong structuration theory, and then throws in some communities of practice from Lane-Renier and the notion of proximate properties from Evan Rapska. I like the stuff that's more in anthropology about Shatsky and Shoen and people like that, but was concerned to not only focus on everyday practices. Because it's very easy to take practice theory to focus only on everyday practice and forget history. And also to have the history there, but not another thing that often happens in published work is somebody will tell you the history and then they will not link it to the rest. It's just like, I've told you that, and now I'll move on and talk about it. So it's a way of trying to bring them together. So the notion of stories was to talk about the narrative accounts or descriptions of processes, and that's just a bit long-winded, but I have realised since then that the word stories might be problematic because it has conjures up all sorts of other ideas as well. So thanks for the question.
Okay, I think we can stop here with the discussion coffee and the food and
yeah. I guess it's like a civilization.
Yes.